Welcome. I'm Kim Ekher and I will take you through the introduction of the 2019 versions of Interform 400 and Interform NG, and a preview of the upcoming Interform NG 2.0 application. Here is the agenda. I will first introduce you to the automotive solution and some new additional integration options for ERP systems, then a few words about Adopt OpenJDK, which is a free alternative to Oracle's Java. Then I will cover the major new features in Interform NG and then Interform 400. As the final thing, I will introduce Interform NG 2.0, which we plan to officially release next year. Regarding our automotive solution, for those not knowing this, this is our software package with a lot of industry-specific content. It's a part of our strategy to make ERP independent industry solutions. And this year we have welcomed a lot of new customers and new ERP partners. The team have worked hard and added a lot of new functionality as well as new templates. Our strategy is to provide you with a solution that works no matter what your ERP and platform is. We already work with many ERPs and now we introduce three new integrations for Navision, Acceptor, and SAP S/4HANA. We have made the new integrations to make it even easier for customers with those ERPs to work with Interform. Reach out to our sales team if you want to know more about these integrations. Some customers are asking us about Java and if they now need to pay extra in order to be able to run Java programs, including the Interform products. For some, there is also a bit of confusion about JRE versus JDK. So in short, JDK actually includes JRE, so you can use that instead of JRE. For those that want to avoid paying for running Java, we suggest that you download Adopt OpenJDK instead of Oracle Java distributions. Older Interform 400 designers install and run under Adopt OpenJDK, but in the older Interform NG versions, there is a test to verify if Java is installed. And that fails if you are running Adopt OpenJDK. But if you are running version 2018 release 21 or newer, then the Java test has been removed and Interform NG just assumes that Java is installed. In the future, we are considering to embed Java directly in our products. So let's start the real presentation and introduce the new functionality in Interform NG. It's possible to write labels with an RFID tag with a new RFID module. In this way, you can scan the label if you're just near to the label and not necessarily able to actually see the label. That means, for instance, you can scan a whole palette of labels in one scan. The RFID labels are required for suppliers in the automotive industry for Daimler, and BMW has now also requested RFID labels for their suppliers. The RFID module in Interform NG is very hot. We have already released it, but now we officially release the module including documentation. In Interform NG you set up RFID in a simple way in the normal template via the special RFID element that you see here. The contents of the RFID tag is defined like shown here. Please also notice that the new requirements for BMW are also included in this module. Let me just show how it looks in the designer. So here in the designer, you click this element to add an RFID element, and you should add only up to one per physical page. Here you set up the application family ID and the contents that you want to put into the RFID tag could either be a constant, but more likely you want to build up an XPath expression to extract information from the input XML file and put that into the RFID tag. Support for the new QR barcode for the Swiss payment standard has also been added in Interform NG, but if you need support for this feature, then you need to upgrade to the developer version 2019 release 512 or newer. And let me show you how you select that. So here in the designer, you click this barcode element to add a new barcode. You don't need to include a barcode style element because there's no settings for this special type of barcode. So after you have selected the barcode element, you select QR_CH here in the drop-down list, and then you just need to put the value, the data that you want to put into the barcode here. And it's your responsibility to put data into the barcode that fits this standard. With this selection of QR_CH, we create a barcode looking like this, with the Swiss flag in the middle and with the specified height and width of exactly 46 millimeters. Support for SVG images has also been added in Interform NG. This was requested by Nolte Küchen, who sells kitchens. The advantage with SVG is that you can zoom in into an area without seeing a fuzzy or edged image. And let me show you an example from the designer. So here in the designer, I have included two SVG images, this and this. And if we do a preview in PDF, then you can see here the image, and let me just zoom in to this heart, for instance, to show you how it looks with a very high zoom. So this is the top of the heart, and as you can see, it's still round. So with this vector graphics, you can zoom indefinitely and you will still see the nice shape that you have defined. Here's another addition to Interform NG. Normally the path that you set up in this metadata key, this one, folder name, that is actually the relative path to the target folder that you specify in the web interface, which means that you cannot create any PDF files outside the target folder. So in previous versions, you would need to blank out the target folder to set the complete path in the folder name metadata. But now you can just precede the path here in the folder name metadata with an asterisk, and then this path here is the absolute path. So with the setting that we have here, a value for the PDF that we're going to generate, and the path, then we will actually create a PDF file named this, placed in this folder. We have had SUGFAT support in Interform 400 for a while, and now it's time for Interform NG. SUGFAT is a German invoice standard, which is actually a PDF with an embedded XML. The real work here is to create an XML file that fits the SUGFAT requirements, but our business partners and Interform can help you to convert XML files into the right format. The setup is shown here. You define a link element, and in the link element, you refer to the XML file that you want to embed. Any specification of a paperclip for this embedded file is ignored with the special SUGFAT metadata key, which you see here, pdf.sugfat.enable. If you set that to true, then you will not see that special paperclip. Also, for the SUGFAT support, you need to specify a very specific resource name, so that should be the name of the embedded file. Also remember that you need the advanced PDF module in order to use this SUGFAT option. And let me show you how it looks in the designer. So here in designer, I first set the value of this special metadata key, and the metadata key can be set with this design element. So you have here the key, and the value is set to true. In my example, I now retrieve the full path and file name of the input XML file, which I'm going to embed in the output PDF. So that is first inserted in a variable called file. And here the next one, the link element, is this one. So you need to insert this element, and I've done that here, and this actually specifies a frame, a box, and that's where the paperclip would normally be included in the output PDF. But since we are using SUGFAT, it will not appear. So here in the link element, we now need to refer to the file that we are embedding. We do this under resource location. So here is the URL of the file that I'm adding into the PDF. The resource name, if we do a preview in PDF, then you can actually see that we have an attached file. Output Schedule Control is a feature for scheduling emails in Interform NG. With this, you can create emails that are sent at a later scheduled time. In the meantime, you can verify the contents and cancel the email. The reasons for canceling could be that you have corrected an error and you want to create a new email to replace the old, or you created an invoice email which is to be changed as the customer now have ordered additional products that should be added to the same invoice. Apart from this email functionality, we will extend the functionality of Output Schedule Control to fit the same functionality of Interform 400 in the coming year. But let me show you how it works. So here under Tools and Schedule Actions, we have now an email that it will be sent later. If I now want to regret this email, I can click it here. So we have the cancel key copied here, and now click Cancel Schedule Action, and the email is gone. For the configuration in your template, you need to use two related metadata keys. One of them is called schedule.cancelKey, which should be a unique key for the email that you're sending out. So here under value, we have the unique key. So instead of a constant like I have defined here, you should normally have a dynamic XPath expression to extract some unique key like a document number from your XML file. Another metadata key, schedule.time, and here you set the time within the next 24 hours of when the email will be sent. The format here of the time is hours and minutes. Interform NG is prepared for MiniCloud. It's now possible to connect a remote client which is able to print, email and archive from a different location. The remote client connects via HTTPS and is configured via a special JSON file. You install the remote client as for Interform NG, except that you need to activate the remote client option during the install. So here you can imagine that you have the Interform NG server in another location that is protected by a firewall, and then you have the remote print client which should have access to be able to connect through the firewall into Interform NG, where you have the remote print server available to connect with this. So let me show you a little bit of how it's configured on the host side. So under output and remote output, you first activate a remote output connection so you can connect with this remote print server. And when you have done that, then you can, for instance, for printers, say that this printer should be accessed through the remote print client. Same goes for archive and emailing. Interform NG is using style sheets. They can be used to completely change the contents of an input XML file before merging it with a template. Style sheets can, for instance, be used in combination with a split so that you can copy header information into the new smaller XML files, and it can also be used for generating a new XML file that, for instance, fits the requirements for the German Suchfert standard. The normal style sheets are normally limited to the functionality found in version 1.0, but with this special prefix Saxon colon, then you can tell Interform NG that this style sheet should be allowed to use the full functionality found in the Saxon distribution of version 2.0. But now let's look at the major new features that have been added in Interform 400. The first thing is one of my personal favorites, and I'm proud of the result. The old manuals was meant to be read from page 1 to the end, and that's of course not how most manuals are using a manual. But the English and German manuals has now been rewritten to make it easier to get an overview of what you can do and where to find it. This includes a detailed index and a search engine. And there are also many embedded videos and cross-references. Let me show you the manual. So here from our homepage, so you can first select via the flags what language you prefer for the manuals. And down here we have the link for the manual. So as you can see here on the left, the major topics of the manual are sorted in alphabetic order. And when you click a section, you see subsections available. And as you can see here, whenever a specific object is mentioned, then it's very often a link, so you can click that link to see more detailed information of that specific topic. Another part of the manual is the large index. So if you want to read something about a specific topic, you can find it here in the index as well. Just click it here in the list. If you're not able to find what you're searching for here in the index, you can also go to full text search and just search for whatever and hit enter. You see the hits down here below. In Interform 400, you need to purchase the RFID module and use the special apasang RFID command in the spool file that you merge with if you want to print these special RFID labels. The overlay used for the merge can be a normal label overlay. Let me show you how it looks in the spool file. So here in the spool file that we're going to merge with, we have prepared a special apasang RFID command with the RFID format that we're going to print, the application format, and the data that we're going to put into that RFID tag. The apasang command cannot be the first non-blank line on a page, and if you want some help from Interform in order to generate these commands and put them into the spool file, then you can consider to use either the create page builder spool file command or a split definition. Another new feature is support for the special kind of QR barcode that is used for Swiss invoices. In Interform 400, you need to activate this Swiss payment standard option in the bottom of the barcode font, and then you need to specify version 25 and error correction M. But the module size here is actually ignored. So with these settings, version 25M Swiss payment standard, Interform will generate a barcode looking like this, which is exactly 46 millimeters high and wide, and with this Swiss flag in the middle. And I can show you how you define such a barcode font number. So here from the main menu of Interform, you select option 80, administration. Option 4, work with fonts. Option 1, description of additional fonts. And now you do 2 to change the font number. Or create a new one with F6. Here you specify the description, module size, version, correction number, and here the new option Swiss payment standard. Here's a change that will make your life easier if you're using large overlay selectors. I've even seen customers that merge all their spool files with the same overlay selector, so the number of sequence numbers can exceed 100. For those customers, I'm happy to announce a new F5 service key with these options: to move definitions to another sequence number, to copy definitions from another overlay selector or within the selector, delete sequence, and resequencing. So here from the main menu of Interform, you select option 4, work with overlay selectors. And then you can change an existing overlay selector with option 2. Hit enter again. And here you can use F5 service, for instance, to copy definitions from another overlay selector. If you do that, then you can prompt here with F4 which overlay selector you want to copy from. Select it, and then you can use F24 to look at the source overlay selector. Specify the interval you want to copy. And we can use F24 again to look at the destination selector. Say I want to place them from 9-10, and then hit enter. If you copy from another overlay selector placed in another file set, then you need to make sure that the referred overlays are also placed in the destination file set, because an overlay selector can only select between overlays in the same file set. PGL is short for Printer Job Language. It is a special printer language that can be used for finishing options on a printer, for instance, stapling. The problem with PGL is that, unlike PCL, there's no standard, so the PGL commands that you need to run for a specific printer depends on the manufacturer and perhaps even on the printer module and the installed finishing equipment. Here are a few examples of what it can be used for. Output bin support, there's a PCL command that can do that, but I've seen a few printers that didn't actually support the PCL command for that, and then you would need to go the PGL way instead. If you in your company have a shared printer, then that printer might support accounting codes. So it means that whenever you print to that printer, you should include an accounting code, and then from the printer you can print out a report to say how much was this printer used by this or that accounting code. And in that way you can share the costs of the printer in a fair way between departments. Some customer also wants to go with the secure print way, or they want to have like a follow me print that you want Interform to send the printout to a special print server that saves the printout and links your printout with a specific user and perhaps even a special password. And then the users can go to this print server and sign on and request their own personal printout. I've also seen printers where color printing was protected by a special code, because color printing is a bit more expensive than black and white printing. So in order to enable print, you need a special code in that printout. And you can of course also add that kind of commands with this feature. Not only can you do all of that, but you can also use variables as part of your PGL command. So in this example, I've used two variables, asterisk V01 and V02. And when you use variables, you should call a program as well. And that program will then get some information about the spool file and what you're trying to do, and then assign values to these variables. So let me show you how it's implemented. So in AutoForms control, you have a function called one merge spool file with overlay, and that function has now been extended so you can call a PGL definition. And when you do that, that definition can also refer to a program. And this program will get the identification of your spool file, information of which PGL function you have to call, the output queue of the printer that we had print to, and then this program can retrieve some spool file attributes, look into the contents of the spool file, and then set the values of the variables for your PGL command. Just remember that if you want to use this functionality, you need to use a PGL printer type for the merge. And also, like a little side remark, these variables can now also be used for stapling. To set up the PGL commands in Interform 400, you select option 80, Administration, then option 8, Work with Printer Control Options, and then 4, User Defined PGL. Here you first select what printer group you want to work with or create a new with F6. And within a printer group, you can define multiple functions, for instance, for stapling, another for printing in color or for setting an accounting code and so on. And here with option 2, you can change the PGL commands for that function. So again, you can see the variables and we call a program. And let me just briefly show you that program. As usual, we have a demo source of that program called PGL Exit in API SRC of APF 3012 library. The source looks like this. We have the spool file identification, not only the usual 5 parameters, but also timestamp and system, so you can uniquely identify any spool file. Then we have the output queue that we are merging to, so this identifies the physical printer where we're printing, what printer group and PGL function that is called, and then you can set up the values for all of these variables. In the bottom of my program here, I've chosen to only set a value for the variable 1 called test. Let me show the result of this PGL. So see here the PGL commands in the start of your printout followed by the normal PCL. The only thing missing is now to call this function in AutoForms control, and I can show you how to do that. Option 5, one function attached to output queues, and do a 2 change for the output queue. Here as the first line, we have a merge. And on the final page, you can activate PGL and set up which printer group and function you want to call. So you can use F4 first to select the printer group and F4 again to select between the functions defined for that printer group. Our customers want to feel safe, so very often old spoof files are kept on the systems even after processing in Interform 400. And in this way, the output queues builds up over time, and so it takes more time to find a spoof file and more disk space is used. But if you set an expiration date on a spoof file, then you can tell the operating system for how long you want to keep the spoof file. In Interform 400, you can set up for how many days the spoof file should be kept on both the split definition and on function A, change spoof file attributes. You just need to run the command delete expired spoof file, this command here, and you need to run that on a regular interval. You can, for instance, put it into the OS 400 job scheduler. So let me show you the new split definition. You reach that through 5, work with AutoForms control, 3 split definitions, 2 change for your split definition, hit enter, select a sequence number, and then on the final screen, you find this expiration date. So that is the number of days after running the split that the spoof file will expire. If you say asterisk input, then the new splitted spoof file will inherit the expiration date of the input spoof file that triggered the split definition. But we also had the function A, change spoof file attributes, and let me show you that. So here from the AutoForms control menu, option 1, functions attached to output queues, 2, change for an output queue, and here in line 4 we have actually a function A, change attributes, and the new feature is written here, expiration date, again the number of days before the spoof file is expired. For our customers, it's important that Interform 400 is running all the time without interruptions, but the jobs that monitor the output queues can hit a problem which will cause the processing of spoof files to stop. And this could be, for instance, by calling one of the many exit programs that you can call. With this feature, you can set up an email address or an email group to receive an email if an error should occur in one of the monitor jobs. You set up the receiver email address per job so that if, for instance, multiple countries are sharing the same Interform 400 installation, then the relevant admin will be contacted. The email includes information of the related output queue, you see that up here, the job involved, and also the error message. So let me show you how it's configured. So from the main menu, you select option 80, administration, 50, email administration, 6, work with email addresses for monitored AFC jobs. Here you see the complete list of all monitored output queues. Here you can do 2 change for one of the queues, and then you can set up an email address or an email group to receive emails in case of a problem. So here with F4, you can select between the email groups that have been defined. Before any of these emails can go out, you need to make sure that you have specified a from address. And you define that through F20, and if you haven't, then you will see a message down here in the bottom reminding you that that is required before any email can be sent. So F20, you set up the email address, and that's it. In Autoforms control, you can also see when a job is monitored. And here, if you go with 5 Autoforms control and 1, you can see here the status of the job is now active MON for monitor. Interform 400 use different measurement units, and for some it can be a problem to convert between measurements. So that's why the new pixel converter has been added. This can, for instance, help you if you want to resize an image for label print. Instead of a lot of trial and error, you can simply calculate the right size before installing it in Interform 400. Type the value in any of the input fields and it will be converted to all the other measurements. So here in this example, a user wants to include an image which should be exactly 5 centimeters wide on a 300 dpi label printer. So here you specify 5 centimeter, and then as you can see here, the image should be 591 dots wide to be 5 centimeter in 300 dpi. So let me show you where it's found. From the main menu, you select 12 service functions, 2 convert pixels, and here you type in whatever measurement you want to convert. And in this example, you can see 5 centimeters is the same as 400 dots in 203 dpi, or almost 2 inches. You have the normal inches here with the normal decimal point. We have also the special inches and pels here, so you can calculate back and forth between these measurements. Here's to the final addition to Interform 400. Output Schedule Control has been with us for many years. You can use this feature to merge many small spool files into one and then sort the new large spool file and process it, for instance, in Autoforms Control. And the result of Autoforms control can then be a printed result or an email or multiple emails or PDFs and so on. So the process is this: you place a lot of spool files in a waiting output queue and some action, for instance a command, or you run it manually through the menu, or you set up to run it at specific times of the week. And that would tell output schedule control that it's time to merge the spool files and process them. But in the previous versions of Interform 400, output schedule control has been limited to the system code page. Spool files in other code pages or even a mix of code pages was a problem, but now we can process almost any combination of spool files. If all the input spool files are in the same code page, then the code page of the output spool files will be the same, exact same as the code page of the input spool files. If all of your input spool files are in the Latin 1 simple set, which means Western European code pages like Danish, German, English, French, Spanish, Italian, you name it, then the code page of the spool files generated by output schedule control will be code page 500. Unless you also have a spool file with a Euro code page, then the output will be in the Euro code page 1148. If you want to have support for double byte character set, Chinese, Japanese, or whatever, or Unicode, then the output of output schedule control will be an AFPDS Unicode spool file. And let me show you how it's configured. From the main menu of Interform, you select option 6, work with output schedule control, 1, functions attached to output queues, 2, change, and here we have automatic start options, You can set up either to support Interword spoof files or Unicode spoof files, not both, one of them. If that is disabled, then we're generating SCS output, and here we can set up the copage for the spoof files that don't have a copage as an attribute. So if we get a spoof file with a normal asterisk DEVD device description on the copage attribute, then we will assume here in Interform with this setting that it's copage 37. So that was actually all that I wanted to go through when it comes to the new 2019 versions of our products. But the final topic is an introduction to Interform NG 2.0. The IT infrastructure is changing and cloud is no longer something we just hear about, and many ERP vendors are pushing customers to the cloud, and we have even a mini cloud solution in standard Interform NG, like you saw earlier. And at Interform, we started this transformation more than 3 years ago. There are many ways of stepping into the cloud, and we cover now most of the scenarios. So here, for instance, you can have the ERP in the cloud and have, of course, Interform NG locally with your printers. Now you can also have ERP in one cloud solution, Interform NG in another cloud solution, and then you would need our remote print client in order to connect your local printers with Interform NG in the cloud. You can of course also have combinations where we have the ERP system combined with Interform NG in the same cloud, still with a local remote print client to be able to access Interform NG and make the connection to your local printers. It's the same product, no matter if you install it locally or in the cloud. So here you can also, of course, have everything locally installed like we have with the older versions of Interform. The major difference, I would say, is that now everything runs in the browser. So let me show you Interform NG 2.0. After you sign on, you get here to the dashboard, and here you see the three main components. We have a designer. We have a library with the resources that we can use for our design and for processing. Finally, we have the workflow where you set up the automatic processing. What should be the output if a specific XML file arrives at Interform NG? But let's take a closer look at the designer. Before I make the design, I would like to refer to a XML file. So I load that. Here in the designer, I want to create a traditional business document. So here on the page, I want to add a header and a footer. Header and footer. So here for the header and footer, of course, that's something goes top and bottom, and then the body here takes up the middle part, whatever is left. And for the header and footer, I actually want to refer to a sub-design, like we know from Interform NG and the Interform 400, that you have another design that you want to reuse across multiple forms. So here for the header, I want to have a standard header included. And here in Interform NG, we don't refer to these elements as a sub overlay or sub template, but we call them components. So here for the components, I can now drag the one or more components into my design. I want my header and I want my footer. If I now go back to my design, I can see that, well, the header, that should actually be in the header part of my page. And here my footer design, my footer component should be in my footer of my design. So now you see header here in the top, of course, and my footer down here. So now you can see here that the body that we have here in the middle simply starts from where the header ends. And then if the body takes up all the space and there's no more place left and it grows beyond the available space, then Interform NG 2.0 will generate a new page where the header and footer will be repeated. So in this case, I want to actually look at bit more at the XML, because I have actually three documents in the input XML. And now I want to do a for each loop, so I iterate across each of the documents in the input file. So we have this functionality, insert for each. We need to refer to a node in the input XML. I double click here to apply. I want to rearrange this because I want actually the page to be with inside of the for each, like so, and the page inside of that. So now I actually generate three pages, one for each document. But I want another for each. I want to iterate across detail lines inside of my of each document. And for that, I want a table. So I refer to this. So it should be two columns wide. And for this table, I want actually a row for each detail line in my XML. So that's why I now right click on the row and say wrap for each. So now again, I can refer to my XML. Find my detail line and click apply. So now we iterate across and make multiple rows depending on how many detail lines we have in our input XML. Now I want to put some data into this table. And here we have sequence number. I want to put that into the first column and the product into the second column. And now we look back at our tree structure here. I actually want to change this a little bit, because here for the text element, I have the full path. I only want a relative path, so I need to cut it down a bit here. And I need to do the same for the sequence number, like so. So that's it. Not only can I do this, but I can also use variables. So I want actually to have a variable that counts the sequence number, which could also be the amount of the current page that I want to sum up these amounts per page and print out a page total for on each and every page. So let me add a new variable, which I want to reset for each document. Do here. Let's call the new variable sum, which has an initial value of 0. And actually want it up here. So each time I print out a new sequence number here, I also want to change the value of my variable so that it keeps increasing each time we see a new sequence number. So I click this and add an update of my variable. Refer to my XML. I only want the relative sequence number of the actual detail line, so that's why I delete this. And I want to add the previous value of my sum and click apply. In the footer or in the bottom of my page, I now want to print out the value of my sequence number for each page. So here we have let me just minimize this to have a better overview. So down here in the footer, I want to print out the value of my variable sum. Do that with the text element. And for that text element, we can say that we want to print out an expression, and that expression could refer to our variable, like so, with a dollar sign in front. Let's take a preview and look at the final PDF. So you see the header, the detail lines, our footer, also the counter down here. Here for this document we have more detail lines, and of course also a different result for the sum. Let's go back to the dashboard. So after you have made your design, you need to set up the workflow, which links an input XML file with the design or a template. So we click the workflow, and I've prepared a couple of workflows that I want to show you. Here's one. So we monitor a directory, and in here we make a choice in order to look into the contents of the XML file that has arrived, so that we can determine what should happen with this specific XML file. So it's like branching out depending on the contents. So here you want to look into the output node of the input XML file, and if that is PDF, then we want to generate a PDF file. If it's email, then we want to email, and otherwise we would in this case want to print out. So that refers to these three branches. So for the first one up here, we have chosen to create PDF, and that's with this one. You can select between the available options. So with this, select whatever function you want to do. And here we have selected PDF and want to save that PDF. An alternative is that you would want to generate an email. So you set up the configuration of the email. And here is the final. Otherwise, we default to printout, and then you just need to select what kind of printout. Could be PCL or ZBL or whatever print data stream you want, and then select whatever printer you would want to send that output to. If you compare the workflow here in Interform NG 2.0 with Interform NG, then there are some more advanced features here. You can actually share variables between the workflow and the templates. And not only that, but you can also use XPath expressions here, and which makes your workflows much more dynamic. And I have an example of that. So here we can make a choice to look into the input XML file. In this case, I'm searching into the contents of the XML, and I'm looking for a node called template, because I want the template actually to tell the workflow what template or what form we should merge with. So I say here, if there is such a node, then we want to do one thing, and if we don't find such a node, then we want to do something else with this otherwise. So that's the two branches that we see here. So if there is actually such a template node, then we want to generate a PDF. But here, the identification of the form or the template is actually an XPath expression that refers to that use the contents of the input XML file to calculate the name. So that's much more dynamic compared to the old Interform NG. So if no such template can be found in the input XML, we just merge it with a standard fixed template and generate another PDF. So that's actually all. The current status is that the 2019 versions of Interform NG and Interform 400 has been released. All the manuals are ready, so it's all available for you now to download.